This is Dr. Segrist, Andrew Segrist, and he is our guest today. And we are very grateful for your contributions to our worship now and in a few moments. Thank you. We also have a guest. Our organist today is Grace Culbreth, and she is with us today and hopefully will be with us for some time to come after we meet with the choir and also kind of explore some possibilities. Grace's family is with us too, and I'll let you meet them at the end of the service, but we won't make them stand up or anything like that because, you know, we didn't tell them we would. There are several announcements on your bulletin. We're glad you're here. If you'll register your attendance, that would be a helpful thing for us. By the way, as you register your attendance, every Monday morning, the Monday morning Methodists go through that list and they check the roll. So they do make sure that you're here. And when we notice that you're not here, they send you a note. They send notes to people who are recovering. They send notes to people who have birthdays and all those kinds of things. And that's an important ministry of the church. We want to mention that so that you'll give them the information to do their work. There are these announcements on your bulletin and encourage you to be a part of all those activities that you can be a part of. On Wednesday at 6:30, we will have a choir rehearsal in the choir room. Grace will be here to meet the choir and to lead them through a rehearsal. And if you are interested in singing with them, please be part of that on Wednesday night at 6:30. Next weekend is a special three-day weekend. It's Labor Day on Monday, and so the church office will be closed. But on September the 4th, we begin our Wednesday connections. We will eat at 6 o'clock. We'll have spaghetti as our first meal together. And this first time we're together, we'll stay together, and we will talk about what we're going to do in the coming month. We're going to be studying the Noah's Ark flood story. And I know you all know that story, and you know everything about that story. But we're going to look at it, and we're going to study it as adults from an adult perspective. The children are going to put together a study from the children's perspective, and they're going to put together a drama which will present to us at the end of the month. And so we're going to look at it and study it together, even though we're separate, and bring it together at the end of the month as well. So come and be a part of that as we begin in September. Are there other announcements that need to be shared? If you were a part of yesterday, we thank you. Yesterday, fish fry was a great success from every way that you can measure it. It did raise money, which is part of what a fundraiser is supposed to do. It also afforded fellowship to all of those folks who were volunteering, which it's supposed to do. I think it was fun. I didn't see anybody grumbling. I saw lots of people laughing and having a good time, even cleaning up. It also offered a space for the community to come together. There were folks who came in and stayed. And it was a little bit nervous at first, but there were people moving from table to table because they hadn't seen each other in months or even years. And so it was really great to provide that space for the community to be together. And I want to thank you, all of you who sold tickets, all of you who volunteered, all of you who fried fish, all of you who carried it out, all of you who did anything relative to the fish fry, because it was a great success. And we thank you for your service. Are there any other announcements that need to be shared? If not, then let us stand for the call to worship.
In the midst of trouble and turmoil, God is our refuge.
God is our mighty fortress
and our shield.
In God's strength, we shall be healed.
In God's love, we shall witness the good news.
Come, let us worship God, grateful for God's wondrous power.
Open our hearts, Lord, that we might truly become bearers of peace and justice.
Amen. The hymn is Stand Up and Bless the Lord, page 662.
Stand up and bless the Lord.
Please be seated. If the children would come forward and be with Ashley for children's time.
Look what I have here. Oh, you couldn't hear me. That's why. What is this? It's a spoon, but it's bent all out of shape. Do you see that? Has this ever happened to you when you're trying to scoop an ice cream real hard and then whoop, it bends? It doesn't work very well. What if I tried to eat some soup with this spoon? Where do you think the soup would end up? I bet it would end up all over me. Well, do you know that sometimes people get bent out of shape too? Do any of you know? It's true. Do any of you know someone that can't stand up all the way? Or if it's from their old age or maybe a disease? Something makes them crippled and they can't stand up? Does anyone know anyone like that? You don't have to name names. Yeah. Okay, well, do you know there's another way people can get bent out of shape? When they're angry over something? That's not that big of a deal. Have you ever heard someone say, don't get so bent out of shape? Have you ever heard that? I have. I've said that before. Well, our Bible lesson this morning is about two people that got bent out of shape. The first person in our Bible lesson had an illness that caused her to slump over. Jesus was teaching in the synagogue on a Sabbath, and a lady came in, and he noticed that she couldn't stand up straight. So what do you think Jesus did? He straightened her out. That's right. He healed her. That's a good way to put it. Well, when Jesus saw the woman, he said, woman, you are set free from your sickness. Then he touched her, and instantly she could stand up straight. And she began to praise and thank God for her healing. Do you know what I think about whenever I hear this? Who's seen the movie Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory? When Grandpa Joe is finally able to get out of bed and then he's dancing all around and so excited, that's what I picture that lady doing, dancing around right there in the synagogue. Well, that's when the second person in our Bible story got bent out of shape. But this person was angry because Jesus healed someone on the Sabbath. The Bible tells us that the leader of the synagogue became very angry because Jesus has healed the woman on the Sabbath. There are 6 days for work, so come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath, he said. Jesus answered the leader of the synagogue, you hypocrite, don't you untie your donkey on the Sabbath and lead them to get a drink? Even so, it was necessary for me to heal this woman who had been suffering for over 18 years. You see, Jesus always was more concerned with healing people and helping people than he was about keeping rules. Rules are good, but people are more important. We should remember that the next time when we start to get all bent out of shape, when someone bends the rules because they're trying to help someone, that that's what Jesus teaches us to do, to help people. So let us pray. Dear God, thank you for teaching us. That helping others in need is more important than keeping rules. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As the ushers come forward, we prepare to present to God our gifts, our tithes, and offerings. This past week on Thursday, I spent a good part of the day in a generosity workshop. And one of the things that they challenged us to do in the generosity workshop was to tell stories. So what I want you to do is, as the offering is being received, is to think about the story of how you received Jesus from someone else. I want you to think about the story about how the gift of God was offered to you by someone else. Because that is an offering that we give to people and we give to God at the same time. Think about the story. It might have been a parent, a grandparent. It might have been a neighbor. It might have been somebody who just said, I'll take the kids to church to get them out of your hair. Whoever it was, think about that story that made Jesus real to you. Let us pray. Dear God, we do thank you for the gift that you give us in Jesus Christ, for the blessing that comes into our lives as we take hold of what you have made possible for us through him. We ask, O God, that as we respond to that gift, that these tithes and offerings would be an expression of our gratitude as they represent the daily labor that we do, as they represent our commitment to you. We pray these things in Christ our Lord. Amen.
You may be seated. The first scripture reading today is from Hebrews. Oh, that's wrong. Sorry, please stand. For the affirmation of faith, where the Spirit of the Lord is, and there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the crown of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Sing the Gloria Patri. Reading from Hebrews 12:18 through 29. You have not come to something that can be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom, and a tempest and the sound of a trumpet, and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that not another word be spoken to them, for they could not endure the order that was given. Even if an animal touches the mountain, it shall be stoned to death. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to innumerable angels in festal gathering, and to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteousness made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. See that you do not refuse the one who is speaking, for if they did not escape when they refused the one who warned them on earth, how much less will we escape if we reject the one who warns from heaven? At that time, his voice shook the earth. But now he has promised, yet once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heaven. This phrase, yet once more, indicates the removal of what is shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks, by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for indeed our God is a consuming fire. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
It is well.
For an abundance of talent and music in the congregation today, we say praise be to God.
Praise be to God.
There are several items of prayer concern that we want to share with you and celebrate as well. Do you have prayer concerns that you wish to lift up? Judy Parker is in the hospital. She has breathing difficulties that she's being treated for, and hopefully will be coming home in the early part of this week. And for Judy and Don, we both pray, saying together, Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Yes, ma'am? Mitchell? Say that last name again. Megehe.
Spell it for you later.
For Mitchell, we pray together saying, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Are there others? The early service, we are asked to pray for the pastor and congregation of one of our sister churches, First Baptist Church of Evadale. And I know you probably had never heard of First Baptist Church Evadale. That doesn't matter, because God knows what is happening there and what needs prayer, and we lift them up together as a fellowship of Christians, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayers.
There's also the walk to Emmaus, which many of you have been on, and which some of you may be considering going on. preparations are underway for walks that are coming up, and some of our congregation are taking leadership roles in that, and we pray for their preparations, saying together, Lord, hear our prayer. We also want to give thanks to God for the activities involved with the fish fry. And it was a great day, as I mentioned earlier, a great celebration of being together and accomplishing some things. And we say, thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Are there other concerns or celebrations we'd like to lift up? Then let us go to God in prayer together and for one another. Great and merciful God, out of nothing, you created all that is. Your voice spoke and brought order. You created and continue to create, offering life to us, offering life to your world. Help us, O God, to respond to you in a way that is an act of worship as we live our lives. Help us to be your people. Help us to reach out in concern and service to those around us. Help us to see those who are in need, those who are ill, those who are not able to cope. Help us to see those who are in recovery. Help us to see those who are in need of any kind, so that we might be your hands, your arms that reach out in concern and work to bring about wholeness. Help us to be your church, dear God, in a way that represents your love at work in the world. We pray that you would enter into each and every part of your church and work through its ministries so that others might know of your great love. We pray these things in the name of our Savior, who teaches us to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our next hymn is The Gift of Love on page 408. If you would stand as we sing.
Thank you.
sermon scripture today is from Luke 13, 10 through 17. Now, he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
So what kind of trouble have you caused today? Really? Have you caused any trouble? Sometimes when I leave the office, Patsy can verify this, I'll say, "I'm going to go see what trouble I can find, what trouble I can cause." And that's sort of a preacher's job, if you think about it. We go and we cause trouble here and there in the lives of people. That's certainly what Jesus did. Jesus was a troublemaker. He really was. You know, when I go to a new congregation, a new building, a new place like this one, the first thing I do is I kind of walk through the building and I look at the signs. And you will notice that in the last 2 years, signs like "Thou shalt not drink coffee in the parlor" have disappeared. I know there's white carpet in there. I'm still not giving 3-year-olds red juice to drink in the parlor. But I think when a family is in a grieving situation and they've got a cup of coffee, it's a little bit silly for them to stand in the hallway drinking the coffee when there's a couch inside the parlor. I break the rules. They were probably voted on by a committee. And I know where those ladies live, and some of those ladies are buried who made those rules. In fact, I buried a couple of them just before I took that sign down. But you know what I'm talking about. We have good rules for good reasons, because people should just know better. And this is not a rule that Jesus is breaking just because, you know, it's a silly rule. This is a rule that is part of the covenant relationship that human beings have with God. You know, this rule about working on the Sabbath goes back really and truly, wholeheartedly, into the Ten Commandments about keep the Sabbath holy. And this is an interpretation of how to keep the Sabbath holy, because God created and then God rested, and we are to emulate God, we are to be like God, and we are to have 6 days to do our work, and then we are commanded to rest on the seventh day. The seventh day of the week, by the way, is Saturday, according to the Jewish reckoning, not Sunday. Sunday is the first day of the week when the women went to the tomb and found it empty and began to rejoice. Remember? So we celebrate the resurrection day, the first day of the week. But the Sabbath is the day of rest. It's the day when you're supposed to do what God did and rest, have a time of reflection and renewal and thinking about what the week had before and what God has in store for us the next week. This cycle of 7 days of rest is important enough for God to include it in the original Ten Commandments, important enough for people to observe it. It is a hard and fast rule. And yet, Jesus seems to violate it. It's not a one-off thing, by the way. Jesus also heals the hand of a withered man on the Sabbath, the withered hand of a man on the Sabbath. And that's also borne witness to in the other Gospels, specifically in Matthew. He heals other people. Sometimes he heals people who can't walk, and he gives them the ability to walk on the Sabbath. Sometimes he heals people who are infirmed in other ways. But Jesus is consistently confronting this action of rules versus people. And every time in the gospel that Jesus is given the choice of either observing the law and the tradition and the rule, or revealing God's redeeming, healing, forgiving grace in the life of that person, every time Jesus chooses the person. Jesus is a troublemaker, because it would be very simple if he just obeyed the rules. Wouldn't it be easier to follow him if he had demonstrated that the rules were easy to follow? Wouldn't it be easier to be a part of his covenant relationship if it didn't break any of the rules? But Jesus challenges people to look at the situation that they are in and to look at the person that they are facing. And when they are encountering that other person, to show mercy and love, forgiveness and grace. Jesus, he's talking to his disciples, he says, I give you a commandment that you love one another. Right? And then we argue about what it means to love one another. And we try to dissect exactly how far we have to go to show love to the other. And Jesus doesn't seem to have any reservation about that. He simply says, love one another. And that means whenever we confront a situation or a person, that we deal with the person, not the set of rules around how we deal with that person. We simply love one another. Jesus does this in the lives of the people around him. He does this in the lives of his disciples. He does this in our lives as well, because he is a person who allows love to override anything that gets in the way of love. In his ministry, every time, love is what defines that relationship. Just think about it. Story of the Good Samaritan. Everybody knows what's supposed to happen. The people who walk by that man are obeying the law and the rules, and the Samaritan breaks the rules. And he's the one that Jesus wants us to think about. That's it. In the story of the gifts of the talents, and a man goes away on a journey and he comes back, and the two people who do what they're not supposed to do, they risk everything. They take everything that Jesus has given them and they risk it and invest it and they double the money. And the master is pleased with them. And the person who follows the rules and says, I kept it safe for you, here's what's yours, the master is not pleased with. Every time, Jesus gives us that example. Love is what helps, is what defines the relationship. And love is what redefines who we are. But there's a problem, isn't there? Jesus did not come to abolish the law. He didn't come to ignore the rules. He came to fulfill the law. He came to fulfill what God had intended and started in the law. The writer of Hebrews gives us a really interesting image of the law and the way it works. He says the law, when we confront it, is very scary. It going to Mount Sinai and how traumatic that was for the people and how people trembled when they saw what was going on Mount Sinai as the law was being received and given to Moses. And if you remember your Old Testament study, you remember that the people who saw the cloud and heard the thunder, they looked at Moses and said, "You go talk to him. We're not going. We're scared." And they were scared, and they were right to be scared because they were a sinful people and they didn't want to be in the presence of a righteous God. Because when a sinful people gets in the presence of a righteous God, we become convicted of that sin and we become stripped bare and shown to be the people that we truly are. There's another part of that Hebrews reading where the people of God, the followers of Jesus, rejoice as they go to Mount Zion. And there's a great celebration happening there because those people are prepared to go to Mount Zion because they have been prepared by Jesus hearing his voice and hearing his word. And as they rejoice and are there on Mount Zion, they know the forgiving, loving presence of God. Even though it reveals who they truly are, even though it strips away the pretense of that we build up, they rejoice because they know that they are being made right in the presence of God. Jesus comes to fulfill the law. He doesn't come to set it aside. He doesn't come to abolish it. He comes to fulfill the law, and the way that he fulfills the law is through grace. Through grace and forgiveness, he fulfills the law. So let's look at that passage of Scripture. This woman, 18 years in this condition, bent over by her disease, goes on the day of rest to find relief, rest from her condition. She goes to the synagogue, the place where God's presence is supposed to be. She is there at the right time to find relief. And Jesus encounters her. And there are those who have seen her week after week in the synagogue and say, "Oh, poor, poor lady." But they do nothing for her. And Jesus sees her, and knowing the law, he fulfills the law by offering her grace and healing. And she is able to stand again, and she is made whole. And those who do not understand the law say, "You just broke the law, Jesus. You can't do that. You're going to upset everything. There'll be people drinking red soda in the parlor." No. Jesus hasn't broken anything. He has fulfilled what God intended. He has offered what God has granted. And as the followers of Jesus, the challenge for us is to ask ourselves, how do we fulfill the law? How do we fulfill what God has offered us as guidance for our lives? How do we allow the love and forgiveness that we experience as God's grace to be shown in our world no matter what? How do we allow that love and forgiveness to be a part of what we call our faithful living? It's a challenge. It really is. You know about the food pantry. You know we have guidelines. You know we do stuff. And at least once a week, somebody walks into my office and says, "We already helped this person this year. We already helped this person this month. We already helped this person a whole lot. But you know, they got like 5 kids, the youngest of which is 3. The next oldest is 5. The others are in school, and they're about to turn off the electricity." And my question is, do we have the money? Right? Because we have rules about that. rule is not fulfilled if we say, well, you've already helped you with the electric bill once this year, we can't do it again. Love trumps that rule, doesn't it? Because we can't let a house where children are living go without water or electricity in good conscience, as a faithful disciple, in any way, if we have the resources to meet that need. You know that. That's how we have to live if we're going to live as the people of Jesus Christ. We have to allow the love of God to flow through us in spite of the rules that we make. There are other rules that are all around us that the church has no control over as well. And I don't want to get off the chart political on you, but sometimes we need to deal with people and not worry about the rules. Sometimes we need to say, if a child needs, a child should get. If an adult needs, an adult should get. And it doesn't really matter what kind of handbag they're wearing or what kind of shoes they're wearing or whether or not they can drive a car or not. It should matter whether or not they are a child of God. Let me just answer that question for you. They are. Everyone you encounter is a child of God. No matter what hospital they were born in, no matter what zip code they have, no matter what nation they represent, they're a child of God. Jesus is a troublemaker because he takes ordinary law-abiding citizens and he tells them to love everybody. And the only guideline he gives them is he says, love them and take care of them and treat them as if you're doing that for me. Wow. And then he leaves us here to be the church, to represent that kind of love in this world. To represent that kind of love in this world. For Jesus, the example was simple and plain. He saw a woman, he saw a person, he saw someone who was suffering, and he relieved their suffering. And he calls us to do the same. He calls us to be his body in this world, sharing his love. It's a world that's complicated. It's a world that has stresses. It's a world that has all sorts of things that keep us from doing things that we think we should do. But it's a world that needs the witness of God's love at work. You've already heard this morning, when peace like a river attendeth my way. We're going to sing it as a congregation now. I want you to think about the ways that God challenges you and the ways that God equips you. I want you to think about the way that God's presence is absolutely terrifying. There's a line in the hymn that says, when the clouds are rolled back as a scroll, that comes out of the book of Revelation, and it is the scariest thing ever, isn't it? That's when the end of time comes. But I will not fear because it's well with my soul because I have a relationship with Jesus Christ, the psalm says. I want you to think about the challenges of being faithful. As we sing this hymn, we invite you to dedicate your life to Christ or rededicate your life to give yourself an opportunity to take up the task of living a life that shares God's love with other people. And as we sing those songs, if you want to do that, you can come forward, make a public profession of your faith, or you can simply do that at your seat. If you want to make this your church home, we invite you to put your membership here and take the vows as well. We'll stand and sing together.
When this high God
shouldn't say that. Oh, all right. Well, that's it. Get out. Cause some trouble on behalf of the gospel. Go out there and live like the people of Jesus, and don't look like the people that live next to you. Live like those disciples who treat other people as precious in the sight of God. Live as those who let love define them. Go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.